And this is the long pause waiting for the thumbs up. We're praying for no storms. Storms outside, no storms inside. Good morning. It is good to be with you this morning, to be worshiping with you, and I hope you're ready to worship. Amen. We're going to begin singing on hymn 338. You don't have your hymnals with you, but that's okay. That's strategic. So you're going to have to watch the screen for the words, but before we begin to worship, let's pray. All right. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to be in your house this morning. Lord, thank you so much for our church and their faithfulness, Lord, and Lord, more than that, Lord, your faithfulness, Lord, to preserve us and to sustain us through these troubled times, Lord. And I pray just give us guidance this morning. Lord, help us to have our hearts attuned to you. Lord, give us help us to feel the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place that we might, Lord, be motivated, moved by you, Lord, to worship you and to live lives that glorify you, Lord, in this time and place. We love you and we trust you in Christ's name. Amen. All right, hymn 338 at Calvary. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. There was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan, oh, the grace that brought it down to man, oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Amen. I get to hear you sing a little bit. I don't know if we're supposed to do that or not, but I'm not going to tell you to stop now. Let's continue to worship. We're going to turn to hymn 294, Set My Soul Afire. Set my soul afire, Lord, for thy holy word. Amen. We're going to sing all three verses.
Set my soul afire, Lord, for thy holy word. Burn it deep within me. Let thy voice be heard. Millions grope in darkness in this day and hour. I will be a witness. Fill me with thy power. Set my soul afire, Lord. Set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. far, Lord, for the lost in sin. Give to me a passion as I seek to win. Help me not to falter, never let me fail. Fill me with thy Spirit, let thy will prevail. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. Millions grope in darkness, waiting for thy word. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. Set my soul afire, Lord, in my daily life. Far too long I've wandered in this day of strife. Nothing else will matter but to live for thee. I will be a witness, for Christ lives in me. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. Millions grope in darkness, waiting for thy word. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire.
Amen. We need some of that, don't we? A little renewal in our hearts, a little revival in our hearts, right? That's what this world needs. It's crumbling around us, it seems, right now, doesn't it? But praise God, He is willing to supply what we need to serve Him, to glorify Him, to reach the lost. And Brother John, I'm preaching, so you come up here and interrupt me, okay? He's going to read for us the Word of God. Would you stand with us while we read God's Word?
Okay, we're going to be reading the 100th Psalm. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to be in your house once again. And Father, I lift up those who are recuperating from medical surgeries and things. And thank you that some of them are here this morning. And Father, I pray for those that are facing treatments coming up. And just pray that you be with the doctors, guide them as they help in these situations. And Father, I pray for our country. So many things are happening now. I pray for your healing on our land. Pray that this coronavirus will go away, and just pray for the things we've seen in the last couple of days and things that are happening in cities across America. And Father, I pray you be with Brother Darren this morning as he brings us a message from your word, and help him to deliver it in the way that you would want him to. And Father, we thank you, we love you, and ask all these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Now we're going to sing from page 543, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. We're going to sing the first and the last. The first and the last.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all His wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Amen. If you're saved today, let me tell you, that's a wonderful promise, isn't it? What a wonderful hope we have. We're going to sing one last song this morning, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord. And if I don't do it exactly the way y'all do it, then just forgive me, okay? We're going to sing and we're going to pray and we're going to worship. So open the eyes of my heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love till we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
One more time.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Yes, I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, 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 I want to see you.
Amen. Brother Dave, would you come? Thank you so much.
I don't know about future, for I know what Jesus said, and today I walk beside him, for he knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow, I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. I don't know about tomorrow. It may bring me poverty, but the one who feeds a sparrow is the one who stands by me. Be my portion, maybe through the flame or flood, but his presence goes before me, and I'm covered with his blood. Many things about understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand.
Kind of hard to
keep that back.
Amen. It's okay to clap in church, just so y'all know, okay? That was good. Good song by a faithful servant. What a blessing. Let's turn to the book of Haggai. We're going to be in chapter 2 this morning. Haggai chapter 2. I'll give you a moment to find it. And then we're going to read our text, chapter 2, verses 1 through 9. Let's read. In the seventh month, in the 1 20th day of the month, came the word of the Lord by the prophet Haggai, saying, Speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Josedech, the high priest, and to the residue of the people, saying, Who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing? Yet now be strong, O Zerubbabel, saith the Lord. And be strong, O Joshua, son of Josedech, the high priest. And be strong, all ye people of the land, saith the Lord, and work. For I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts, according to the word that I covenanted with you when ye came out of Egypt, so my spirit remaineth among you. Fear ye not. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land, and I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come. And I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. Let's pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we are so much in need of you today. God, we live in a world that is just seems like it's just changing so fast. Lord, just in the last few months, so much has occurred. So much has changed, Lord. 2020 has not necessarily been a peaceful year. And Lord, we feel that. We feel the discouragement. We feel the fear. We feel the burden of need for you to come and to heal this world. God, we need you. Lord, I pray this morning as I preach, Lord, allow me, Lord, a worthless worm. Lord, I pray you let me be used by you. And God, I pray that you'll fill me with the Holy Spirit. Give us clarity and direction, Lord, from you. I pray for our church, those that are hurting, those that need healing, those that need revival, Lord. It's all of us, I think. God, renew our hearts and help us to serve you better. We love you, God, and we trust you. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Last week I began a series, and we're going to go through the entire book of Haggai. Don't worry, it's only going to take 3 weeks, and we already went through one of them, right? Haggai is a short book. It's only two chapters, I believe 38 verses, if I'm not mistaken. And Haggai is a timely message when it is given. But I also believe it's a timely message for the here and now. But I think I said this last week. I don't know. I was too pumped up to really focus really well on everything I wanted to say, but that's okay. The title of this series is Renew the Vision. We have a need, any church, I'm telling you, has a need to renew her vision of what God intends for them to do. Last week, we saw the children of Israel who had not been in a good situation for some time. For a number of decades, they had been out of their homeland. They'd been taken back to the place of Babylon, and they had been, the glory had been stripped from their nation. The temple that Solomon had built had been destroyed, and finally, through only God's provision, they had been allowed to return to Jerusalem. But they're still not their own nation. They're just this ragged city-state who's clinging on and trying to regain their national identity as just this city-state, as one of the provinces of Persia. Not all things are going well. But God has not left them. And God, in the last week, this last chapter we looked at, God reminded them of their purpose. They were to be a people who worshiped God, a people who followed him in every step of their life, who allowed him to rule their nation. At this time, they didn't have a king. So really, naturally, God, as God had intended, their king was to be God, not this pagan king of Cyrus. He told them, if you remember, those cutting words, consider your ways. He said, remember your purpose. Renew your purpose in me. Build my house. What a challenge, amen? A challenge that I think applies to this church. Build my house. And we're not talking about a building. But this week, you know, God gave that message, consider your ways, commanded them to build the house, and praise God, they responded with obedience and worship. And they began to build. A few weeks into that, they began to build. And we find them in chapter 2 struggling a little bit. We get another timestamp. I talked about last week how they got this timestamp. Haggai chapter 1 was, that message was delivered on August 29th of 520 BC. Pretty cool that we can narrow that down to then. But this message is on October 17th of the same year, just a few weeks later. And this is a notable day. This isn't just another day. This isn't, we can go back and look at the history books and we can try to find what happened on October 17th, 520 BC. But the only thing we're going to find is that Haggai gave this message from God to the children of Israel. But this day was important because it was the last day of the Feast of Tabernacles. An important day for them. And this last day of the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of Tabernacles was a time to worship, to praise God for his provision and how he had delivered for them. But we don't find the people necessarily worshiping. Some are struggling. If you turn to Ezra chapter 3, Ezra chapter 3, and I'm going to try to turn there. I should have marked it now that I think of it. Ezra, where are you? Oh, where art thou, Ezra? You know, that's one of those books that just kind of eludes you, doesn't it? Ezra. In my book, it's page 430. All right? If you don't have a Bible like mine, then you're going to have to find it on your own. I think this is important we go to Ezra. It gives us a little more context of what's happening. Ezra chapter 3. This is the same time, same events are taking place. And we're going to start in verse 8. Ezra chapter 3, verse 8. Now in the second year of their coming unto the house of God at Jerusalem, in the second month came Zerubbabel the son of Shealtiel and Jeshua the son of Jozadak and the remnant of their brethren, the priests and the Levites and all they that were come out of the captivity unto Jerusalem and appointed the Levites from 20 years old and upward to set forward and work on the house of the Lord. Then stood Jeshua with his sons and his brethren, Kadmiel and his sons and the sons of Judah together to set forward to the work, the workmen in the house of God, the sons of Henadad with their sons and their brethren, the Levites. And when the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, they set the priests in their apparel with trumpets and the Levites, the son of Asaph, and with cymbals to praise the Lord after the ordinance of David, king of Israel. And they sang together by course in praising and giving thanks unto the Lord because he is good, for his mercy endureth forever towards Israel. And all the people shouted with a great shout, and they praised the Lord because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. Sounds good so far, but let's read the next verse. But many of the priests and Levites and chief of the fathers who were ancient men that had seen the first house, Solomon's temple, that had, when the foundation of this house was laid before their eyes, they wept with a loud voice, and many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not discern the noise of the shout of the joy from the noise of the weeping of the people. For the people shouted with a loud shout, and the noise was heard afar off. They've begun building and they've laid the foundation, but it wasn't what it used to be. And the young guys were excited. All right, we're finally building this again. We never got to see the temple before. But they're excited and they're fired up. But then there was those old guys. 60, 70 years old. Had seen, maybe old, probably a little older than that actually, since it had been nearly 70 years since that old Solomon's temple had been built. We see their discouragement, right? They're weeping. They're crying. I mean, Solomon's temple had been a world-class building, gilded inside, on the inside with extravagant decorations and impressive tapestries, but that was built when Israel was united, right? Wealthy, at the apex of its power. But now Judah doesn't even have a king, right? Judah's this sub-province. They're hanging on for survival, surrounded by enemies. Funds are limited, resources are limited, and by comparison with the memory of Solomon's temple, it's just not good enough. They've begun to build, but discouragement has set in. God has a way of dealing with our attitudes, doesn't he? I have 4 children at home. And as you can imagine, attitude sometimes is an issue we must deal with. Right? And even for myself, sometimes attitude is an issue I must deal with. And oftentimes I find myself reminding my kids or myself, attitude equals outcome. Y'all ever heard that before? Attitude equals outcome. The first thing we see that God does is he asks 3 questions to address their problem. He wants to address the people's discouragement, because if they get bogged down and get fixated on the past, well, they're not going to accomplish the purpose for which God has called them to. What is the first question he asks in verse 3? He says, Who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? The second question was, what does it look like now? And the third question is it not as nothing in your eyes? I mean, think about these questions. These sound encouraging? Not quite, right? But God here is acknowledging their discouragement. And he wants to address their problem. And the problem is their attitude, their perspective. Where are their eyes? Why are they so fixated on the past? Now, nobody that you know does that, do you? Do they? I mean, do we ever get fixated on the past? I can think back. I grew up in Northeast Baptist Church. Great church. Wonderful pastor who's still pastoring there. And when I was growing up at Northeast Baptist Church, we had at least as I remember it, a vibrant youth ministry. And we had an even more vibrant drama ministry. We put on skits. Let me tell you the fun videos of this guy right here out there, okay? And I will never let you see them if I can help it. Every year we'd have Roundup Sunday, kind of like a friend day. And Roundup Sunday, we dress up in Western duds and have a little boot contest. And then we'd eat brisket and all the fixings, right? And there in the drama ministry, we had created a way to promote this with the Roundup Boys. So we had a few goofy teenagers dress up like cowboys. I remember a few of them. There was Loose Lips Little. There was, I think it's Wild-Eyed Waldo. And then there was Shifty-Eyed Simpson. And we'd ride in on our stick horses, and we'd promote Roundup Sunday. And it was fun, and it was exciting, and it was silly, and it was good. We had a vibrant drama ministry that didn't do just silly skits like that. We also would do an Easter presentation. And we'd go through the life of Christ, and we'd share the gospel with whoever would attend in form of drama. Let me tell you, I got some very fond memories of those times. But you know, that ministry's gone. I mean, can you look back at your life in church and your history in church and go, man, where did the time go? And that's all gone now. I haven't been here very long. I don't know what we would consider glory days at Northwest Baptist Church. These guys were focused on the glory days of Solomon's temple. That was their perspective. God asked these three questions to address their problem, to really call out their attitude, to call out their perspective. But let's see how God responds to their discouragement with words of encouragement. Let's read verse 4 and 5. He said, Yet now, be strong, O Zerubbabel, saith the Lord. Be strong, Joshua, son of Josedech, the high priest. Be strong, all ye people of the land, saith the Lord, and work, for I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts. According to the word that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, so my spirit remaineth among you. Fear ye not. He had asked three questions to address their problem of discouragement, and now he gives them three commands in response to their problems, to their bad perspective. He says, listen, you've been reflecting on the past, but now it's time for present action. And he uses words that are so familiar to them. He said, be strong. Have you ever heard God say that to anybody else in Scripture? All the first one pops in your mind is Joshua, right? Joshua chapter 1, verse 6 and 7, and also in verse 9, he said to Joshua, be strong and of good courage. And how many times did he say it? Three times. Four times. I think you're right about that, brother. That's right. He said it three times to Joshua and once to the people, if I remember correctly. Joshua actually had heard this before. He heard it from Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 3. And then King David had said this to Solomon. Whenever Solomon was preparing and David was helping him to prepare the idea of building this Solomon's temple, this great, it was God's temple, but we call it Solomon's temple because Solomon got to build it, right? And so clearly this is an important phrase to their Jewish history. Be strong. What does that mean? Be strong. He's saying, be strong, be strong, be strong. And then he said, for I am with you. You know, many times when we get our perspectives off base and we are struggling through a situation, what do we try to do? Well, we either sit and weep, or we complain about our circumstances like we saw those guys doing in Ezra. Stuck in the past, wishing the glory days were here instead of back there. Or we might just try to muscle through it on our own strength, right? Or what we might do is just reject God and go in a different direction altogether. But God says, be strong. And he added, for I am with you. Let me tell you, there's no way that we're going to be strong without him. Right? He's the anchor that will hold us through the storm. He says to be strong. Be steadfast. Plant your feet and move forward and continue to move forward. Don't give up. He said, be strong. And then the second command he gave was to work. You know, the problem of their attitude couldn't just be remedied by telling them to work. You know, if you're struggling through something and you're trying to, you know, stick with a task, but it's difficult, it's more difficult than you expected it to be, and someone just comes on behind you and goes, hey, would you just get to work? Get after it, man. What's the problem? Work. Is that very motivating? No, not really. But God said, no, not only work, but work knowing that I am with you. For them to work, they needed courage. And the only place we're going to be able to be strong, the only place we're going to be able to find courage is in our God. And He is with them here in this text. He is with them, and it says in verse 5 that He is with them just as He had been with them when they came out of Egypt. You know, the circumstances are tremendously different for them here, right? But He's with them, just like then. His strength is still available to them. His power is still available to them. And His Spirit is still available to them. It says, "And so my Spirit remaineth among you." He says, "Be strong, be steadfast, and work." Hey, listen, building the house of God is going to take work. Amen? It's going to take work. It's not a pie in the sky, easy vacation, is it? Hey, listen, you go on vacation with kids, that's work too, right? But this isn't a vacation without kids, it's work. It's like Zechariah 4:6 said, "Not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts." They were not going to be able to do this in their own strength. They couldn't. He wasn't telling them to be strong in their own ability to stand fast and to trust Him. They weren't going to be able to do this in their own ability and their own work. They're going to have to do it by His power, by His might, by His Spirit. And then right there at the end, He gives one last third command. He says, "Fear not. Fear ye not." It's almost like, there's an implied therefore right there. And right before you see that word fear. Fear ye not. They were in a fearful time, in a fearful place. But God told them, "Hey, stick to it. Do the work. I'm with you. Therefore, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid." So God had asked three questions to address their problem of discouragement, to call out their perspective. He'd give them three commands in response to this problem. And then He makes three promises to eliminate this problem for them. In verse 6, "For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. And I will shake all nations, and the desire of nations." Who is that? Oh, who's the desire of nations? It's Christ, amen. "And the desire of nations shall come. And I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter house shall be greater than that of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts." He gives them three promises. He supplies them with motivation. The first thing He told them was, He said, "I'm going to shake the heavens. I'm going to shake the heavens, the earth, the sea, the dry land, and every nation. I'm going to shake them up." And praise God's people don't belong to a nation that can be shaken. Amen? We are on unshakable ground. But God is going to shake the heavens. He's going to shake the earth. He's going to shake up this world. And He did that. We see Him do that later on when the Lord comes. In the first incarnation of Christ, we see how it shakes up everything. And it also completes that second promise that He gives. He says, "I will shake all nations, and the desire of nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory." You know, The Lord Jesus walked into the temple, didn't he? And can you imagine the glory that he brought in with him? People may not have seen it, but oh, it was there. And not only did he bring it, did he bring that glory because of Christ, when Christ entered there himself, ultimately this will point to when Christ returns the second time. He said, I'll shake the heavens, the earth. The latter glory of this house will be greater than the former. And the third promise he makes, in that last part of verse 9, he says, and in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. He's going to bring peace. I think if we look back at their former perspective, fixated on the past, wishing things were better, I think if we listen to what the Lord is saying, he's saying, do my work, and I will deliver. Stick with it. You're still doing God's work. It doesn't have to be the same as it was before. It doesn't have to be like it was when you were a kid. In fact, oftentimes that doesn't work. But it's still my work. And I will still bring these results. Don't you want to see those promises fulfilled? You know, we have an opportunity in this day and age, God willing, to shake this nation with the gospel. Or at least the city. Or at least our neighborhood, right? We have an opportunity to shake the world for the gospel as we send out missionaries. And that's work. It's not just writing a check. It requires prayer, attuning ourselves to their needs, partnering with them. Don't you want to see the promise of the Lord filling the temple? You're going to see it. I'm pretty sure I'm speaking to redeemed Christians this morning. Okay? I think all of you, if I'm wrong, then please, I'm going to tell you, today is the day of salvation. But if you've trusted Christ, you put all your faith and trust in him, someday you will see this promise fulfilled. And that last promise, in this place I will give peace. Listen, Christ has already done that through the cross, hasn't he? Romans 5:1 says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God has brought peace to us. Colossians 1:20, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. Or Philippians 4, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep or guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Ultimately, we see God give these promises to the children of Israel in this difficult time. He gives them, supplies this motivation to them to know that their work will not be in vain, that God is going to bring peace to the world, and it's going to be done through the temple, and it's going to be done through Christ. He says, let me tell you, he has brought peace to us. And it is sweet. I look at our circumstances in our world today, it's amazing that we have the freedom to meet here right now. It's amazing that we are gathered as a body in this building. It's amazing that we're able to broadcast a sermon from God's holy word that is just a little bit polarizing out for anyone in the world to see. But we are free to do it. But our circumstances are not all rosy and happy. We live in a world who, frankly, doesn't want us to be here. We are surrounded by enemies. And it's easy for us to get stuck in the past. It's easy for us to get our perspective off. But we need to heed these words the Lord gave to children of Israel. We're to be strong. We're to work and to not be afraid. What do you think would happen if a church clung to these words and lived them out? What would happen? I think we'd see God deliver. He's going to do it with or without us, by the way. But oh, I want to be part of it, don't you? I'm going to ask Glenda to come. We're going to have a very short time of personal invitation where you're at. We're still not presently able to come forward. But if you have business to do with God, now is an opportunity. It is so easy for us to get our perspectives off, right? To get our attitude where it shouldn't be. Maybe we need to have a change of perspective. God is with us. Doesn't his word say, if God is with us, who shall be against us? Our anchor is absolutely sure. We live our lives, I live oftentimes my life as though my anchor is just... Well, it's in just a bed of seaweed and clinging to nothing that's sure, but our anchor is Jesus Christ. As we read this, he identified himself as the Lord of hosts, the sovereign, almighty, all-powerful God, which no one can withstand, which no one can overcome. We're going to have a deacons meeting tomorrow, and we're going to talk about what changes we're going to try to implement to continue to reopen our church, and we're going to be talking about the future. And let me tell you, Northwest Baptist Church is not a dead church. There's life here, and there's work to be done. I pray for wisdom to know how to lead you. God will lead me. Amen. That's what we need. We need him. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your word. Lord, I don't know if this is just for me this morning. The words, be strong. Lord, it is uncertain our times. And Lord, from an earthly perspective, our future is uncertain. But God, help us to quit casting our eyes around here, down here. And help us to be strong. Fear not, to do the work, knowing that you are with us. So long as we stay true to your word, stay true to the work, the calling that you've given us, you are with us. Lord, as I prayed this, the beginning of this sermon, we need you, God. I need you. And I pray, Lord, that you come upon us, fill us with the Holy Spirit. Help us to feel your presence, just as the children of Israel experienced your presence exiting Egypt. Lord, help us. Help us to be strong. Lord, I thank you for this time. I pray for this church. Help us to be encouraged by your word. We love you and trust you in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you so much for being here today. If you do have a need to communicate with me or any of the pastoral staff, you can share that online. If you're tuned in, you can share that online. Or there are cards here that you can fill out, the phone number and some information on how we can connect, and we can pray with you, talk to you. But I'm going to ask you, pray for your church. I don't know that there's, we often downplay the power of prayer. We don't do it audibly, we don't do it in our minds, but we do it with our actions. We need prayer. This world needs prayer. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for tuning in if you're here. We're dismissed.